fear because you are going to attend exams in the future. You are also going to attend interviews. You are also going to attend meetings. Keep upgrading in your life most of the time. Let's understand what is fear actually. Let's understand what is this fear. Okay. Then we will talk about why this fear, and then also we will see what is the solution. Okay. The simple way to overcome fear is just overcome. बोलते हैं ना लोग कि अरे डरना क्या है यार, डर के आगे जीत है. इन हिंदी जैसे डायलॉग में डर के आगे जीत है. Just overcome it. Just like you know, when it comes to self-control, there are people who are not able to control themselves. They take alcohol or drugs, and they are not able to control. People give suggestion, you know, self-control. But it is very easy to say that just do self-control, but it's very difficult to do. The same way, overcoming fear is very difficult. Just by saying that you know, overcome fear is not possible. So the shortest solution is that just overcome fear. But the longest answer is. To understand the longest answer, you have to first understand what is fear. See, fear, there are two types of fears, okay? Let me explain with examples. I'm just trying to explain in layman's way. You may not probably find these technical or the jargons of the internet. See, one is rational fear and is another one is irrational fear. It means rational fear means where you're supposed to fear. It makes logic, and the irrational fear. I'm going to give examples, okay? Let's say I'm on the top of a building. It's a 10-story building and there is boundary on the terrace. I'm on the terrace and I look out from the 10-story building and I get fear, right? I have the fear of height. But the question is, why do I fear that height? I mean, I'm on a safe environment. There is a big boundary in front of me. I'm anyway not going to fall. Until and unless somebody comes and lifts me and pushes me down, I'm not going to suddenly, you know, fly up and go down. I know that I'm in a safe environment, but why do I fear that height? Otherwise, another kind of fear is that, especially when we're children, we are fearful of dark rooms or dark places. Somebody tells us to go, so even adults are fearful of that. Somebody tells us, needs to go to the other room, which is very dark, we get fear, right? But why? I think, see, darkness is different. If there is a darkness on the road or if it's 1 o'clock at night, that makes sense. Somebody, some criminal can come and do murder, or there can be a thief also on the road. But inside your house, what is there to be fearful about? As if some ghost is going to come and eat you. Have you ever heard any story in the whole world where bachcha gaya tha andhere room pe bhoot aake kha gaya? Have you ever heard this story anywhere else? But we still fear, right? Going into a dark room, imagining something. Another good example just came to my mind suddenly. Okay? See, when we walk up or down staircases, maybe to the first floor, second floor, when there is boundary on the stairs, let's say there is one side of the stairs, there is a wall, and the other side there is definitely a boundary, right? Probably a grill or something will be there. And it has never ever happened. Has it ever happened to anybody that you were walking on the stairs and you lost your control, you were about to fall down? Just because there was a boundary, you got saved. Has it ever happened to anybody? Personally with me, it has never happened. I don't even realize that there is a boundary on the staircase. I don't even notice that. It goes out of my mind. But what if I'm going to the same stairs and there is no boundary? I will simply get scared of it, right? What if I fall down from this side? But it has never happened that this boundary has ever saved me of falling down. Because it has never happened that while going on a staircase, I have lost my control and I was about to fall down. This has never happened. But still, if there is no boundary, I get the fear that I may fall down. Some kind of irrational fear. But there are logical fear also. Let's say I am here and somebody comes to tell me, there is a terrorist attack in my neighborhood. There is a definite reason to be fearful. If somebody says, if I am with a group of friends in a jungle and there is a tiger, somebody comes and tells me that there is a tiger on the jungle, it's a definite reason to be fearful, right? But most of our fears are irrational. The question is, why are these irrational fears coming? The exam is often irrational fear. I'll explain to you. But before understanding, okay, why these fear are coming to our life, let's understand what is fear doing to you. What happens when you are in a fearful situation? Now, pay attention to this, okay? I'm going to explain to this properly. What happens when you are in a fearful state? You see, the mind has the brain, physical brain, I'm talking about. The physical brain has got three parts, okay? One is the rational brain or logical brain. Other one is the emotional brain. And the third one is the survival brain. Okay, survival brain. It means it helps you survive. You see, as the name suggests, that rational brain means it uses logic. You do calculation, you do analysis, you are using a rational part of the brain. Emotional brain is that when you get emotional, as the name suggests. And survival brain is when you are in a survival state, let's say tiger is chasing you, or as I gave the example of a terrorist, you are there to survive right now. You have to survive. The first thing you will do is how to survive, right? If a tiger is chasing me, the only thing I'll think about is how to survive. I'm not going to use any logic. My rational brain and my emotional brain will shut down. The survival brain will take up. Because I am in a fearful situation, there's a tiger chasing me right now. I just have to run. Ah, very good example. I remember just now. This is very real life example, okay? You see, when there are fires in buildings, you must have seen either live or probably in news, okay? You must have seen that suppose there's a fire on the fifth floor or sixth floor of a building, people go out to the balcony, they try to survive, there's a fire inside the house, they're trying to survive. You must have seen that some people will jump from the fifth floor or the sixth floor when there's a fire. The fire is inside the building, they are on the balcony, they are probably on the portico or maybe somewhere hanging, okay? They will jump by themselves, not falling. I'm not talking about falling. There are people who fall and there are people who also jump. Probably, if that person did not jump, he would have got saved by the firefighters within 5 to 10 minutes. But that person has decided to jump. The person knows that if the person jumps from the building, he is anyways going to die on the ground. He's going to break his leg or head and he's going to die. But instead of standing there for some more time, he has decided to jump. Now, if I'm sitting here, somebody asked me, is it a good decision to jump from that building if the fire is inside? Or is it a good decision to wait and let the firefighters come? Now, when we're sitting, we will definitely think that if you jump down, anyways, you're going to die. Be there for some time, the firefighter will come and save you. But they decide to jump. This is a very real-life example. Why does that happen? Can you imagine the situation when there's a fire inside a building? Your survival brain will take up everything. It will dominate your logic and mind. You will not be able to take any logical decision the way we are doing right now, sitting here in this comfortable room. When there's a fire, your logical brain will shut down. Your survival brain will start. The only thing you will think about is how to survive right now. You cannot make logic that if I jump from this now, I'm going to die, I'm going to fall on this, I'm going to hit this dustbin, I'm going to fall on this car. No logic, just survival brain. What I'm trying to say is that when you are in an extremely fearful situation, your survival brain takes over. Logic starts down. My question to you is, when you go to an examination, do you want the logical brain to work or not? If the answer is yes, that you want your rational brain to work during an exam, do you think that it is good not to have fear during an examination? The more you fear, the more your rational mind gets shut down. This is the worst thing that fear is doing to you. The time when you need the most of your rational brain, you are in a fearful situation. So you got the problem till now, that what is fear doing to you, especially during examination? So the next point comes is, why fear? Okay, why do fear happens, especially during examination? And then we'll come to how to somewhat, not completely, somewhat you take care of the fear. Any questions till now?
I want to share something. I have a fear of water, aquaphobia. I know it is an irrational fear, but sir, I want to share something. That sir, for example, I am in the shower, and when I shower on, I feel that it will lead to flood, and now I will drown and die. So I don't know why मैं बहुत बार ऐसा फील करती हूँ तो सर मैं एक मिनट से ज्यादा शावर बाद नहीं ले पाती एंड देन आई टर्न ऑफ द शावर आई डोंट नो व्हाई और जबकि ऐसा कभी होता नहीं है नो वन कैन डाई नो वन कैन ड्रॉन इन द शावर
एग्जैक्टली
इट इज सच एन इलॉजिकल फियर आई नो बट आई डोंट नो व्हाई दैट आई फील दैट आई विल ड्रॉन इन द शावर आई ऑलवेज थॉट दैट इट विल लेड टू फ्लड आई डोंट नो व्हाई
No, it happens. So, as you rightly yourself said, this is a very illogical fear. And one way to avoid fear is by facing fear. That's the one of the most easiest way to avoid fear is by facing fear, especially illogical fear. Only illogical fear I'm talking about. I'm not saying that, I don't. Fearing terrorist is also a fear. So I'm not saying, I don't want to fear terrorist and go inside when there's a terrorist attack. I'm not saying that.
I am giving you one very interesting example because your talk is so innovating and in fact it is so interesting to me and I am also listening to it. In fact, you're a good speaker, I know. And that's why I also got mesmerized by the way you are plainly, very simple way you are presenting the total thing from the very beginning till now. I'm just adding one interesting comment by Oscar Wilde. Oscar Wilde was asked that what is fear and what is the fear of the whale? Because we all are afraid of the whale and it can take you immediately in its stomach. So when you're in the sea. So Oscar Wilde told that it is better to be yourself entering into the stomach before it itself takes you to the stomach. So, to be in the stomach of the whale is the easiest way to overcome the fear of the whale.
That's a logical fear, definitely. Nobody wants to go in front of a whale.
Yeah.
But as Anjali said about fear of the water in the shower, that is very illogical. Okay, then. Anybody else who would like to share anything or ask anything?
Others are very brave.
I just wanted to ask that is anxiety and fear are both the same thing?
Almost, not completely.
On what grounds they are different actually?
To make it simple, fear is mental. Anxiety is actually somewhat physical also. You get sweat when you are anxious, right? You get shivering. That's a physical
application.
But fear not necessarily mentally fearful, right? That is one prime difference. There is a noise from somebody.
Yeah, please mute your microphone. Mute microphone. Whose microphone is doing? It's terrible sound. Okay.
Somebody's Varsha, are you talking?
Varsha's, she's going to talk, but the sound is not coming. Whenever she wants to talk, the sound is coming. No, your terrible sound is coming.
I think from Varsha's mic there is sound. She mentioned very
often. Rather you keep the video. Yeah, then you talk now.
No, actually, Vaisha wanted to speak.
Yeah.
But if there is a problem, you can type your question on the.
Yeah, type your question. Type your question.
Okay. Tell then, we will take it.
How to overcome these panic attacks or anxiety attacks?
Okay. For that, two, three ways are there. One thing is to really think about it logically, about anxiety and fear. That's what I was about to come. How to think logically why this fear is coming. And secondly, on a physical level, very simple. Okay? One very simple thing that I'm going to tell you, whenever you have fear or anxiety, take 5 deep breaths. 5 deep breaths. It may not completely remove your anxiety, but the reason we deep breath work is that, you see, the body, the human body also understands the environment. Okay? When we take deep breaths, it is a message to your brain that everything is fine outside. Even if things are not fine, your body cannot see. Okay? But when you take deep breaths, it's a message to the body that everything is fine outside. Relax, relax. That's why in a very layman's way also people use, you know, I mean, dharma tyar, lambi saanse le, everything will be fine. In a layman's term also you use this, right? Deep breaths, everything will be fine. That is why the simplest way is to take some deep breaths. Second is, whenever you have fear of something, think about the worst thing that can happen. What is the worst thing that can happen? What is the worst thing? If you have some fear, I mean, is it even fearful than a person holding a gun on your head and who is going to shoot, put the trigger in the next 10 seconds? Is it even fearful than that? Put yourself in a situation which is even more fearful than this. See, this is something that I use. This technique is something that I use, okay? This is both helpful in terms of when I'm in a fearful situation or when I am in a very depressed or sad situation. This thing has practically helped me, okay? And this is something that you can also use. If I am in a very fearful situation, let's say, or in a very sad situation that I don't really like, I think about myself and put myself literally in a very different situation. For example, okay, now let's say I have a situation right now and I want to get out of the situation. What if I was in Syria right now or in Yemen where there is a war going on? Okay, let's say I put myself in that situation and I am with my family inside a building and anytime a bomb can come and fall on my head and my family would be gone. There is no food to eat. What if I'm in an African country where there is no food to eat and people are dying of hunger? I literally put myself in that situation and close my eyes and think about myself in that situation. And then I ask myself, now that I'm in that situation, how much I would pay, I'm talking about pay money, how much I would pay myself or somebody else to take me out of the situation and put me in the current situation that I'm right now. I ask myself, I don't like the situation right now. If I am in Yemen in a war-torn country, how much I would pay to somebody so that that person takes me from that situation and put me in the present situation that I'm right now? And usually, the money goes very high. The answer comes from my heart that I would give all my wealth in my life, whatever I have, to go out of that bombing situation and come back to this present situation. So it's just a perception, see. Here I'm trying to avoid this situation, but if I am that situation, I literally want to come back by paying. So it's all about perception. So what I'm saying is that think about the worst that can happen. In terms of example, let's say, what is the worst thing that can happen? You may fail. You may just have to write the exam once again. That's all. Or maybe you may have to give a break of 1 year in your career if you fail in the subject. What is the worst than that? Nothing else. So two ways. One is take deep breaths to come out of any anxiety or fearful situation. And secondly, I mean, I have given two different examples. One is on a physical level, one is on a mental level. On a physical level, take deep breaths. And on a mental level, put yourself in a worse situation than that and then thank, be thankful that this situation is much better right now. There's nothing to fear about. Okay. Now, let's come to why we fear. Why we fear? Okay. This is something that that is very interesting. I liked when I learned about this, that we humans are different from animals. We all know that. What is the difference? One prime difference between humans and animal is that we humans, just a moment before I continue this, Ratan sir, is it okay? We have another half an hour to go.
No.
Shall I continue or give a break? We can continue, right?
No, you continue. Only 20 minutes left.
Okay,
no?
Okay. That's what, exactly. No, I actually initially thought that let's give a 10
actually,
minutes.
Actually, we are doing the total video for this last 1 hour. So naturally, you continue.
Okay. Fine. All right.
But earlier video is a little disrupted because we didn't know how to do it. Now we are already settled. So tomorrow, I think we can do the whole video at a stretch. But today, last 1 hour and then half an hour like that. Okay.
Great.
You continue.
Okay.
Dr. Moshumi Mallik, you come on the video if you can. If you are free to come, you can come. She is a faculty of our department. She joined. So I request her to come to the video. Yeah. You can come.
Yeah, I'm actually recording the video.
Okay. You do this.
Okay, fine, ma'am.
Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, so what I was trying to say, the difference between animals and humans is that we humans have two superpowers. Listen to this, very interesting. You have never thought about this in that way, I'm sure. We humans have two very superpowers which animals don't have. One superpower is memory, a vivid memory. We remember things, and that is an advantage. You see, animals do not remember so vividly like humans. I mean, they do, like dogs can remember the owner, dogs can remember some roots, dogs, and even there are incidences where lions remember, tigers remember, but not vividly, I'm saying, the way we remember. We can even remember something that happened in the childhood, right, that is there in the memory. That is a superpower for us. That we remember so many things in this single brain that we others don't, all no other animals does. So it is an advantage. Now I have studied engineering. I know how to use the things that I have used learned in engineering to make my future. That is a superpower of humans. I cannot teach engineering to a dog or a cow. They do not have any memory power. That is a superpower. Second superpower is imagination. We can imagine something, right? Dogs, animals cannot imagine. Is there anybody who think animal can imagine something? Do you even think?
Yes, in Jonathan Swift's Gulliver's Travel, okay. Book 4, Jonathan Swift imagines that the horses are more imaginative, more educated, more intelligent than human beings.
No, I have never heard about that. I have never heard. Good that you mentioned, you know.
Yeah.
Okay. They are more imaginative, is it?
Yeah. In that imaginary tale of Gulliver's Travels, Gulliver was traveling to different lands and his shipwreck. After the shipwreck, he went to the strange islands. And last one is Lilliput land, one is Brobdingnag land, and the third one is the scientist Laputa, and the fourth one is the horses land. So when he went to the horses land, he thought that the horses are more intelligent. And horses did not allow him to stay there because he wanted to stay permanently in the land of the horses. So he tried to show that I'm a reasonable person. I'm also reasonable like you, intelligent like you. But horses did not agree that. Horses told that no, human beings are very, very emotional, sentimental. They don't have much intelligence. So they cannot stay here. Okay, and so you don't have much imagination also. And horses have the highest form of imagination. Yes, horses are very rational even in Aristotelian concept also. The Greeks also thought that horses are very important. And in India also, the elephants are regarded to be very intelligent in South India. So if you call in Bengal or Assam, if you call that you are like an elephant, then people will be angry. But if you call this in South, if you go to Kerala or if you go to in Tamil Nadu, if you say that you are like an elephant, they will be very happy because you at least compared him to an elephant. So if you compare one to a horse in Gulliver's Travels, then it will be very a good thing that you are compared to a horse, because horses are more intelligent than human beings. Now these are all imaginary tales, not real. But it is in our course also, MA students, that's why I told this here. Anyway, for your break, actually, for giving you some rest, I was sometimes interfering, so that you can take some rest. You are talking for almost at a stretch for 2 hours. That is a big job that you are doing. Thank you. You again continue, no problem.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Is somebody else trying to say something? Nobody? Okay. That's what. So I was talking about this imagination power of human, and then the memory power of human. You see, these two, memory and imagination, these are our instruments. They are our tools. I have a knife. I will use the knife to cut. I am using the knife. The same way, I have the power of imagination. Like what I'm going to do next after this session. What I'm going to do tomorrow. So it's a superpower of humans to set up, to control their life, and memory also, to control their life. But what is happening nowadays is that these two superpowers that we have are actually going against us. Anybody, actually this is something that I have learned from Sadhguru. Okay, if anybody has heard Sadhguru, Vasudevi Sadhguru, he talks a lot about this. And I am actually kind of, you know, telling his own concept that he uses to you all, that imagination and memory are our superpowers. We should be using them. But it's happening the complete opposite way. Right now, if I think about some bad incident happening in the past, I feel bad. In the present moment, I'm feeling bad because something had happened 10 years ago. You see, my memory is actually becoming a problem for me instead of being a tool for me. The same way, if I imagine a bad situation that is going to happen, let's say I have a presentation in front of 1,000 people tomorrow and I get frightened, I get fearful, I get anxious. What if something goes wrong? What if I'm not able to present properly? What if there are tough questions being asked? I'm imagining things that those things have not yet happened. That is going to happen maybe tomorrow, day after tomorrow, 1 week later. That time has not yet come. But I'm suffering right now thinking about the future. You see, one power to bring back the memory, one power to bring back the future to the present moment. And both these powers are coming to the present moment, and instead of making our life easier, it is troubling in the present moment.
That's a stream of consciousness technique. That is, that this is the stream of consciousness technique in a positive sense.
That's what I was telling, that you know, this is something that I learned from Sadhguru, and I started thinking that this is so true. I mean, why we are using our superpowers as humans to even make our life horrible? Now why I'm talking about this imagination part is that fear arises mostly because of imagination. Fear arises mostly because of imagination. I'm in an exam. I am fearful because I think that something may go wrong. I may fail the exam. Even though I know that I have prepared myself completely, I still get fear because I think that I may not be able to write properly on the examination. Fear arises because of imagination. I imagine in the present moment, the next 2 hours is going to be very worse for me because I'm going to fail. And when do you get fear? Fear arises before the results. Before getting the results, you get fear, right? And what else? Where else we get fear? We get fear or anxious before presentations, before public speaking. Public speaking is one of the biggest fear, you know that? It is even higher than fear of death, it seems. There is a survey. Fear of death comes second. Fear of public speaking comes first. What is the reason for fear of public speaking? What will people judge? When I'm talking, what if I say something wrong and people judge me? Fear of public speaking. But that is not sure, right? We are not even sure whether people will judge or not. It's an imagination. So, do you understand why this fear is coming? This because of the imagination power of humans. The same imagination power which was supposed to be a tool for us, it has become a problem. Using this same imagination, people have made big buildings, people have made rockets, people have reached the moon also using the same imagination. But if this same imagination is torturing you out of fear, then it is time to remove fear. So I have told you how fear is shutting down your logical brain, especially during exam time. You definitely need your reasoning brain. Fear is shutting down. Secondly, I have told you why fear comes. It's because of imagination, right? Terrorist attack wala fear that I have told you, that is not an imagination. Definitely, if you go out when there is a terrorist attack, you may die. That is a different fear. Irrational fear is because of imagination. So think in this way, that your imagination is your superpower. It is not a problem for you. Don't use this superpower against you. Use this superpower to build your life. And I have also told you techniques of how to go out of fearful situation. I'm just repeating. One is that physical level, take deep breaths. Okay. And on a mental level, put yourself in the world. Think about the worst situation that is going to happen. And think that this is not a big deal. Okay. Think about life. I mean, all are going to die one day. Everything is going to be over. This video calling you, your physical body, your family, this earth, this planet, this universe, everything is going to be over one day. And you are worried about an examination. Comparison, see? Okay. Any other questions?
Sir, I have got one observation to share with you. Please, if you permit me, then I can go on.
Yeah, please.
So as today's session is about mental health and this academic motivation during this exam time, so I want to share some few words about mental health in general. Where I can see that these sessions, these are some lot of some initiative, and I wish this session should be done in every colleges and even schools to increase the awareness,
exactly,
of people regarding the importance and well-being of psychological health.
Exactly.
And also, speaking about this mental health, in many portions of our country, I have seen that it is still considered as a social taboo and a negative stigma is attached around it. Because I believe this is a very narrow mentality. But in the cities, people are getting educated and being at ease when these topics are aroused and discussed in public, but the progress is extremely slow. So I think that the time has come to be inward looking and self introspection must be done in order to rescue ourselves from getting our mental health at stake, I think.
Right. No, very true. Yes. Cut yourself from the external world and look inside. And most people don't even understand what do you mean by look inside. For that, probably we may have to take different sessions. But just understand that there is a world outside you and there is a world inside you also, which you can access by cutting your five senses that goes out. I mean, what I'm trying to say is that that becomes complicated. See, our hand, the five senses that we have, see, hear, smell, taste and touch, these are all outward bound, right? We can see something that is outside us. We can touch something that is outside us. So, in yoga, there is something called pratyahara, which means cut all the five senses outside and try to look inside. There is a beautiful world inside you as well. That's what you said, you know, self-introspection is very important. Actually, Parsha Vera, I've seen her question just now. She asked a question. I actually have fear of dreams. Sometimes it goes to extreme level that I can't even sleep in night. How can I overcome it? You see, when I was a child, even I had the fear of sleeping at night. I actually forgot to mention. I did not have fear of dreams as such. I was fearful of sleeping at night itself. I was fearful of sleep. I thought that something would happen when I'm sleeping. I just want to be awake all night. So I can understand the situation, probably the same situation. Obviously, you get dreams only when you sleep. See, for that, I would suggest that you start doing some, you start reading, thinking positive, and do some meditation. Meditation will definitely help you.
Long breath, as you told, I think it helps. Long breathing, yes. Yeah.
Long breathing.
Yeah.
Before sleeping, rest your mind and give a message to your mind that everything is all right outside. As I said, long deep breaths means giving a signal to your brain that everything is fine outside. The same way, take some deep breaths, give a message to your body that you are going to sleep, everything is fine outside, and spend 15 minutes doing meditation every day. Just quiet your mind. Or else, what you can do is, see, meditation not necessarily means that you have to not think of anything else. That is not the only way of meditation. That is one type of meditation, but not the only way. Think of some positive situations in your life or positive incidences that has happened in your life. And while doing meditation, think about that situation again and again. Repeat that situation in your mind mentally. And the moment you think about the situation, you get a positive vibration in your body. Mental thinking has effect on your physical body, your physiology.
I'm sharing some experiences because I'm an aged person, so naturally, you know, the sleeping, yes, is a problem for all the aged people. And you know, I'm sharing this because of the students, they should know this at their young age. Actually, when I was young, then I never thought of this kind of thing, that I cannot sleep, I cannot dream, all these things, because unless you sleep, you cannot dream. Abdul Kalam, APJ Abdul Kalam told that if you do not sleep, then how can you dream? That is the thing. So dreaming is okay with sleeping, that is not a problem. Problem is if sleep does not come. Now in the middle ages, when I was almost 40, 45 like that, that time I suddenly had a problem that sleep was not coming to me. And I almost stopped sleeping. And whenever I go to sleep, I heard my heartbeat. I saw all the things that I did all the day and what I did earlier days. Everything comes to my mind, but I cannot sleep. That is the thing. Then I started taking sleeping pill also for some days. I consulted doctors. Doctors told me that you take some kind of tension-free kind of thing. Not sleeping pill exactly, but tension-free some name. I forgot now. So I took them for nearly 2 years. And after that, whenever any person, any student came to me with the problem of telling that, I said, I cannot sleep, sir, I cannot. In those days, students have very close connection with us. And they're almost like family members, and they came to our houses, and they used to ask sometimes at night, sir, I cannot sleep, I am very afraid. Then I was advising that you take some medicine like this, and stress nil, I remember that tablet, stress nil tablet. And that tablet I was taking, and I also advised them also to take stress nil. And one student took stress nil before her MA examination, and she passed with first class marks, because the earlier night she could not sleep and she forgot everything. After taking stress nil, in the morning she was quite fresh and she gave the exam and told me, sir, I am very much happy that I took the stress nil. Now, this is almost gone. These days are gone. Because last 10-15 years, you know, I did not take any medicine like this, sleeping pill or this. What I did, I just did some, at that time I had some army training, and I was doing some that asanas, that is, one is shavasana, and what we are doing, from the leg to the head, I have to come. And I imagine that I have no toe, then I will think of myself that my total figure without my toe. Then I am imagining that, then think of yourself without the leg. Then I don't have leg, and I'm thinking of my body without the leg. Then I think I have nothing but the head only. Then I think of myself at the head. In this way, I will again go down, I will again come up, I will again go down, I will again come up like this. Then one person told me that do another thing. Count 100 in reverse serial. 100, 99, 98, first. No gap in middle. and you take long breath and you count the 100 to 1 like this. Then I did all these things. After all, what happened? I stopped everything. Okay. The last 5 years, what I'm doing, you know, I had to wake up in the, it's a compulsion almost, I had to wake up in the morning, early morning, 4, at most 4, 4.30 like this, because my daughter is in USA. So naturally she talks around that time, and after that they sleep, because our 6 means they are 9 p.m. So naturally up to 6 I can get talk to them. So at 4 I wake up, okay. And even in the night also, I work up to 12, 1 like this. So I only sleep 3 hours, not more than that. But those 3 hours are very deep sleep. Okay. And what I do, after 6, I take my brush and everything. And I take some tiffin also. And then I again sleep. Now 6 to 10, 11, I sleep. Okay. And this comes automatically. Then I read one psychological book. And they told, don't go to bed when you do not sleep. You do not feel like sleeping. The moment you feel like sleeping, you go to bed. Before that, don't touch the bed. You just sit anywhere, on the floor, on the chair, on the table, wherever you want. But don't go to the bed. Because bed is a kind of thing that you are dreaming of the bed. Bed is such a thing where I can sleep. That kind of thing, dream will be there about the bed. So bed is not that I must sleep at 10. It is a compulsion. In that case, sleep will not come. Sleep will come only when you make sleep optional. Because the moment you make a thing compulsory in your life, you cannot accept it, you cannot achieve it. So that kind of theory, I think it is very effective. Means I sleep only when I feel sleeping. Yeah. And I am telling you one experience of mine. Once I met a doctor, he is a normal doctor, our MD doctor. So one patient came to him and told him, sir, I cannot sleep at night, I want to work whole night. But in the daytime I can sleep. Is it harmful for my health? Then the doctor said, it is not harmful. You can sleep at your own time. You can wake up your own time. But the problem is the world will not sleep according to your time. And world will not sleep, wake up at according to your time. So naturally you have to adjust to them. That's why you have to sleep at night. Otherwise, man can sleep at any time. But suppose you sleep at daytime, then you can go to office, you can go to college. That is the problem. Others will not be doing like you. So only to adjust to others, sleeping time is night. Otherwise, for no other reason that you must sleep at night. That is the only reason. And Sukumar Rai, who was writing a poem on this, he told that the most strange thing in life is that flowers bloom without any sound and sleep comes only at the night. It is very natural. And people wake, it is only at the daytime. And we can see when we keep our eyelids open. That is also a strange thing. And when we sleep, our eyelids already close. That is also a strange thing. So all these strange things make our life very common.
Right, good sir. Thanks for sharing the story.
Yeah.
And she actually saying that, you know, fear of dreams also. That's what Vaisha. You have to do some meditation, learn some meditation techniques and do it for 5, 10, 15 minutes before you sleep and deep breaths. And this is actually not good. That, you know, you are in fear of a situation most of the time. This is not good on a long run. You have to overcome this. That's all. So that's all. I think I am done. Any other questions if you have?
Students, you have any question, because last 5 minutes will be for questions only. So if you have any questions, you can ask. And you can also tell how you like the speech and how you like the talk. Dr. Moshi Mollik, if you...
Please unmute yourself. Sir, Dr. Sir, on mute.
Dr. Moshi Mollik, if you can come to the video, at least you will be in the video for 1-2 minutes. And also tell something to Dr. Mr. Bituban Borua about a speech. Dr. Moshumi, you are here?
Yes, sir, I am here. I was actually just recording the video. That's why I couldn't talk myself.
Okay. Others, if you can tell anything about this lecture, are you benefited? And how much do you like Mr. Bituban Borua's speech?
And also,
let me know what you want to talk, me to talk about tomorrow, so that I can write down the story.
Yeah, yeah, that also you tell.
Sir, I think it was a brilliant lecture, and we have got some exceptional insight into these topics. And I'm sure that this will arouse enough awareness in the students and other people who were here to look at this lecture, like us, about the mental health. And I also, as I have said before, that modern society is completely getting enmeshed in the pursuit of getting materialistic pleasure and competitiveness. So harnessing the power or capacity of inward looking and self-introspection is not happening. So I think that should be done in order to become more self-aware about things.
Right.
True. Yes.
Rishabh is there, Rishabh Basu? Anjali?
Yes, sir.
You tell something?
I want you to discuss something about anger issues, frustration, depression.
Anger.
So because I have anger issues, so I want you to, discuss about these things.
Sure. Tomorrow we can discuss.
Any other suggestion?
Sir, can you discuss about, I have heard a term about spiritual upliftment. So, sir, can you discuss it tomorrow?
Sure.
If you are okay with it, if you can discuss the effect of subconscious on a real life.
Subconscious on real life.
Any other suggestion from any other students? Chandrama?
Yes, sir.
Somaba?
Sir, overthinking. I want to know about overthinking.
Yes, good topic. Somaba?
Yes, sir, I don't have any special requests, actually.
Anunna?
I'm mesmerized with Sir Beethoven Borwa's lecture. But I don't have any special
things. Okay. Bikram?
I want to know about phobia. I think phobia is different from fear. Also,
yes.
Uncomfortable.
Yes.
Jyoti, Namrata, Ananna?
I want to suggest about addictions.
Yes, addictions. Good topic. Okay. Very good topic. Yeah.
Addiction and a half.
I'm sorry, your voice is breaking. Come again.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Sir, the actual is very good, and it was really informative. I wanted to ask about depression and overcoming.
Depression, okay. Sure.
Sir, overcoming racing thoughts while trying to sleep.
Okay.
Yes, so why a good topic? Payal, any topic?
Yes, sir. I just want to ask about phobia.
Okay.
Phobia. Okay.
Sir, overcoming from negative thoughts and overthinking and stress.
Priyanka Agarwal, Priyanka Kapoor, Jyoti Shah.
Yes, sir.
Tell. Pooja Yadav.
Overthinking is the main problem.
Are you overthinking right now?
No. After listening to lecture, I am very much relaxed.
Night is the time when we overthink the most.
Exactly.
Hey, one topic is maybe there, swinging of moods, mood swings means bipolar disorder.
Yes,
there are
sir,
many,
yes,
many suffering from bipolar disorder. Just now happy, just now angry, just now very much depressed, just now very enthusiastic. This bipolar disorder, I think, is one very common factor in the mind of the students and young people.
Sir, I also want to ask about panic phobia.
Sorry, what? Panic?
Yeah. Getting
panicky.